Joining me right now is Oklahoma Senator and Senate Homeland and Governmental Affairs Committee member James Lankford. Senator, great to see you today. Thanks very much for being here. What do you want to see happen out of President Biden's trip to Europe?
Well, first thing he could do is step up and say we can provide more energy to Europe. Europe right now is very dependent on Russia for its energy. That puts them in a very bad spot, and Russia's counting on that long term that that Europe is going to cave because they can't keep the lights on, can't keep heat going there. We can greatly accelerate our pipeline capability, our export capability. It will take a couple of years to be able to get to that spot, but there are a lot of sources that we can actually provide to be able to help Europe long term get off Russian natural gas and Russian oil. We've got to be able to see additional sanctions, but the Ukrainian people are also looking for practical things, equipment to be able to move faster. We're making announcements that things are coming. The Ukrainian military is saying, when is that actually coming? They want to be able to see the logistics arm that we have actually move at a faster pace for weapons to be able to get to them. They've specifically asked me for body armor and helmets to be able to get to more places, to civilians and other areas, so they can continue to be able to defend their own communities. So we've got a military need and a civilian need, the sanctions, and then cutting off long-term money to Russia.
I mean, why wouldn't we be doing that, Senator? This seems like an easy answer. I mean, are we just talking about optics, that the president would have to, you know, turn around and say, well, the climate change agenda being the priority, no matter what, has failed, and I have to redo the XL pipeline. I've got to walk back the moratorium on federal land drilling. Is that what it's about? Optics? He doesn't want to have to admit that it was wrong.
Pure and simple, it's just optics at this point. Even the Biden administration's own numbers from EIA, the official agency that counts up what they predict will be the energy needs for the world and for the United States, that group from the Biden administration predicts we're going to have an increased need globally for oil, gas, coal. But the Biden administration has determined we're not going to produce that here. That's going to be produced somewhere else. We're going to try to meet our climate goals here in the United States, but we're not going to actually produce it here in the United States. We're going to import it. So the Biden administration is very focused right now on making it more expensive to do export of natural gas, harder to be able to do natural gas pipelines, harder to be able to do drilling, or impossible to be able to do drilling on federal lands as they continue to be able to block off new lease sales. And they hide behind that there are 9,000 leases out there, use those. They know the game with that there may have leased one plot of land and an oil or energy company is exploring in that area, but they're not going to do large amounts of capital for the whole region unless they can fill in the checkerboard that's around them and they can actually prepare for the future. Biden administration knows that full well, but they continue to be able to say, well, we've done 9,000 leases. They're not using those yet, and they know the trick there. So this is all about meeting their climate goals. They seem to be in charge, but what's happening now is those climate activists are giving money to the Russians so they can murder their neighbors.
This is just extraordinary. I mean, on the one hand, domestic policy, we need to unleash the potential for America to become energy independent. And on the other hand, it's this slow walk to help Ukraine. Many people I've spoken with tell me that the president is making this assumption that it's inevitable that Ukraine falls. But intelligence professionals say, no, there is a path to victory. President Biden is now reportedly preparing to roll out new sanctions targeting hundreds of senior Russian officials and lawmakers. Senator, is that going to do anything? I mean, is that going to move the needle, or are we going to sit here and watch Vladimir Putin create death and destruction in a peaceful, what was unprovoked country?
That's correct. So what's interesting is you use the word that Biden is slow walking it. These sanctions on Russian leaders in their parliament was asked for by Zelensky over a week ago now, that Zelensky made it very clear to Congress and to the president, please put all these sanctions on. It's now been slow walked for days to actually get to it so he could go to Brussels and make a big announcement there. Zelensky saying, do it. Stop talking about it. Actually do it. Literally, people are dying in the streets in Ukraine while Biden is worrying about where the optics are best to be able to make this kind of announcement. Just do it and move faster through all this process, whether it's delivering equipment, making announcements, adding additional sanctions. But we have to move from punishing people that are murdering their neighbors to stopping people that are murdering their neighbors.
I mean, the foreign policy decisions out of this administration continue to just be questioned. I know you introduced a Senate resolution. I want to talk about what you'd like to see happen with your colleagues last week, urging the administration to facilitate the transfer of the aircraft, the MiG-29s, to Ukraine. What is the difference between the MiG-29s and the Stingers that we've sent? I mean, why not send these jets so that Ukraine feels that it can have air cover?
Yeah, there's no reason not to send those jets. Obviously, we've sent Stinger missiles that actually are surface-to-air. We've also installed additional S-300s that are also surface-to-air that are helping them with their air defense. And the Biden administration seems to say that's enough. When Zelensky's saying it's not just getting surface-to-air, we actually need ground cover. We need individuals to be up in the air while our forces are moving on the ground, so we're protecting those individuals. You can't do that with a surface-to-air missile. You've got to have aircraft overhead at that point. Anyone who's been in infantry, anyone who's talked to people in the Army will tell you they want folks overhead as well while they're moving, and we're not allowing that. And they keep saying it's 24 jets. It seems like a lot, but this is a country the size of Texas. Allowing an additional 24 jets is not provocative. It helps them be able to defend their own nation. We should actually have those jets already there and stop just dithering constantly.
Well, Senator, I don't understand the decisions at all on foreign policy. I mean, beginning with Afghanistan, but then there's the wide open border. We were just talking with Christopher Olivares from the Texas Department of Safety, and we know now that the administration is considering ending Title 42 as early as next month. The pandemic-era health provision allowed the White House to remove illegal migrants from the U.S. because of COVID. Senator, you were briefed by immigration agencies about the plans to begin interior processing. What can you say about the ICE facilities, like the ones that we captured? I was the first journalist to actually get into one of those facilities. Fox News cameras captured this in Brownsville, Texas, earlier this year, releasing and transporting immigrants into the United States. What is happening in terms of this wide open border, Senator?
So a wide open border is about to be even more wide open, according to the Biden administration. If they release what's called Title 42, they're basically saying the pandemic is over, even though we're still wearing masks on planes and they still have all these restrictions on Americans. If they declare suddenly the pandemic is over on the border, we're going to have a million additional people move across this border in the next few months. A million additional people. You think of how bad it was last year as people were moving across in all these facilities and all those images and overcrowding. You're talking about doubling that number for this coming summer, and the Biden administration seems to be more focused on just relieving the chaos of the border but actually moving people across rather than actually putting policies in place that'll stop this. There are two key things that can stop it. Actually do the remain in Mexico policy, which they say they're doing. I've been down to Brownsville. They're not actually doing. They're letting everyone come by and only getting a fraction of people so they can declare they're doing it when they're not actually doing it. The second thing is, if you're the most recent person that crosses the border, you're the first one up for a hearing. Right now, if you cross the border illegally, they allow you to be able to come into the United States. They give you a piece of paper, let you go anywhere you want to go in the country, and you have a court hearing 6 years in the future. 6 years. So when they release Title 42 and have another million people come in, this is going to make a bad situation even worse. They are truly opening up the borders to anyone in the world.
Yeah, including terrorists. Marsha Blackburn told me 34 terrorists have been encountered. People coming in, they were on the terrorist watch list. And by the way, Senator, we haven't even discussed the Iran deal. Why are we hearing nothing about the Iran deal except whispers that it's about to be imminent, that the U.S. is back in the Iran deal? Real quick, Senator, we only have a couple of seconds.
I can tell you, we're tracking all this. I was just on the Senate floor last week talking about this. I continue to be able to push it, but you're right. The Russians are actually negotiating on our behalf, dealing with Iran. It is the ultimate horrible foreign policy mistake, again, of opening up access to Russia to Iran to be able to continue to communicate, to be able to allow nuclear weapons into Iran. It's a foolish mistake.
You can't write this. Honestly, you cannot write this, what's going on right now. Senator, thanks very much. We appreciate your leadership. Senator James Lankford joining us this morning in D.C. We'll see you soon, sir. We'll be right back.
See you soon.